afternoon, everybody. How is everybody doing? Good? Come on. Come on. How is everybody? Great. Perfect. Thank you. And that's great because we're going to have a very intense session where we're going to be talking for 40 minutes about all these interesting ways to get hackers excited. Pretty much, we're going to be looking at the hacker's perspective, meaning we're going to be the hacker to see what hackers can actually do nowadays in the organization. And also, we're going to be getting into the protection methods as well. So just a couple of words about myself. As you can see, I'm the CEO of CQURE. I got a very business role in our company, which is right now 11 years in the market, dealing with cybersecurity, also having access to the source code of Windows. But my real passion, and that's what I still do, is to do penetration testing, so attacking customers from various perspectives. That's why this session today, so that you guys can see how the practitioner's perspective looks like. Now, whenever we are thinking, of course, about this Microsoft role that you can see on the slide as well, just for the reference, I'm not working for Microsoft. Even though I get this funny role of a Microsoft regional director, I'm not working for Microsoft. I'm not a director, regional maybe, so what is this for? In general, this is the role for someone that is innovative in technology, in Microsoft technologies, but not only that. So absolute honor. This is also one of the things that I'm doing. Okay, guys, so no time to lose. Let's start. And before we even get into the whole situation, whole stories, I would like to share with you a little bit of a story. And that story goes like this. We do, as you already mentioned, pen tests. And eventually, what we do as well is social engineering. And I'm going to be absolutely open with you, yes? Because when we do social engineering tests, it's not a very like ethical thing. But who cares about ethics in cybersecurity, right? So eventually, at our company, there are two people doing social engineering tests, and I'm one of them. And there are three reasons for that, actually. And again, not to offend anybody, I'm just very open. Being a woman in the men's world simplifies things. Sorry, it's a fact. Second, I really like to talk. And third, I really like to talk to strangers. So basically, every opportunity for the conversation, it's a great opportunity for me to become more familiar with who is this nation out there, the human nation, and how do people behave in these different types of situations. So, story goes like this. I'm at the customer site in Switzerland, and I'm on a street level, and my job is to get inside the building and steal information from the finance-related organization, from the trader's room, from the dealer's room. So I'm supposed to sneak in, do something bad, get the information out, and leave, yeah? Or hopefully run away. So long story short, there are like three points of entry, yeah? So one point of entry is I can call them at the door, and I can see where they are because they are noted at the building. So I am able to press the button, there's this big bulb camera, but I don't want to do it because they're going to see me. Point of entry number two is to use the PIN, which I don't have, and point of entry number three is to use the card, and the door will open to the elevator area, but I don't have a card. So what do? Typical thing, sometimes we do it. I do the tailgating, pretty much I stick to someone's back. Yeah, you can always turn, someone can always pretty much turn around. You can pretend this is not really like intentional. You can laugh. And again, female thing, ha ha ha, you can do this. And that works. Brutal, yeah, but okay, anyway. So that's pretty much what I did. So I'm in the elevator area and there are two elevators, elevator A and B. And what I'm doing, I'm leveraging a little bit of a, again, female stereotype because I've got like a big bag with all the stuff inside, so I'm searching through things and so on. I look concerned, why? Because I don't have a card. I don't have a card to enter the office. So there is this guy coming in, and I can see that he's actually pressing the floor number six because this is where I wanted to go. And this is one of these elevators where you cross the floor outside and it shows you A or B. So I can see pretty much who is using what kind of finger to press what kind of button. And then I can see that this guy is doing it, perfect. So the door is opening, I'm running to the back side of the elevator, and here's a question to you guys. Why did I do that? Why did I run to the back side of the elevator? What do you think? Shout out if you can. Because? yeah, I can, maybe I can get out on any floor or something like that, but my interest is in a floor number 6. So I'm going there together with this guy. Right, so I can hide behind this guy, right? So I can also check out his mobile phone. If he's pressing something, doing something, I can kind of like do a sneak look. Absolutely true. I can also talk with the guy, yeah? And I can also do a little bit more things. So let's learn what happened. So when the door shuts down, what I'm doing, I'm starting the conversation. And I'm like just saying, starting in regular conversation, and I'm saying, hi, how are you doing? With a little bit of a smile, you know. So this guy replies back, and he says, I'm fine, how are you? And I'm making a little pausa. Why do I make pausa? Because pausa keeps people waiting for something that he's like, curious. So the more pausa you make, the more weird it's going to become. But the appropriate pausa makes people curious. So I'm saying, and how are you? I'm fine. And then silence. And he's like, say something, yeah? And I'm saying, nice to see you again. And he's like, nice to see you again too. I'm thinking, liar, because we never seen each other before. But eventually, word again, it's magical too, because it makes people to kind of motivate themselves to say something nice to us. Nice to see you again too. Almost feels like I'm a little bit of a shame admitting that I don't know your face. Yeah? So check, check, check. Next thing, I decided, because he got all the checks, so I decided to bring this conversation to the next level. And I'm saying, and that's going to be tough, so check this out. I'm saying, you smell very well. Okay, yeah, this is where the story ends, by the way. But the funny part is that he says, oh, you think so? I'm like, mm-hmm, that's it. This guy is done, yeah? So long story short, what happens? We get to the 6th floor, the door opens, he keeps his back straight, he lowers his voice, and then he takes his card, he does the pick, he opens the door, and he says, ladies first. Probably in the nicest way to do the social engineering, right? So what I did, I took the pen drive, and basically this particular company was announcing to the employees that, hey, we care about your cybersecurity, we implemented policy, that we're gonna lock your desktop after 5 minutes of inactivity. Great. So everybody's like, yay, they take care of us, so they don't have to do anything. So in the trader's room, when the guys finish a couple of things, they stand up and they leave without locking their desktops. And sounds like a boring stuff, we all know, but this was my point of entry. I managed to sit down on one of the guys' desks, I copied the documents, and then I'm sitting over there and I'm starting to provoke situations because nobody asked me what I'm doing over there. Imagine that. So eventually, I started to yo. I did like, very rude, right? And then people were looking around, they were checking, and it's like, what is she doing, and so on. Nobody asked me the question. Even though I was poking on people, I was like, hey, hey, you, wearing that red shirt, how are you? No questions. So basically, I was bored another day at work that nobody picks you up. Eventually, nobody recognizes that you are actually a danger in the company, and I'm leaving with a sad face because situation goes over and over again. And I'm doing this for the past 10 years, and there was only one situation when they got me. That was an HR director. She was screaming after me in a parking spot, don't trust this girl. That was a bit humiliating, but eventually it was funny. Anyway, so we've got 3 things, awareness, behavior, and culture, and that's what we're gonna be also focusing on, that cybersecurity goes under a big umbrella, not only involving technology, but also involving things like social engineering, things like cooperation with vendors, things like various assessments, which we're gonna summarize at the end of this presentation. So whenever we are thinking about all these cybersecurity things, it would be nice to summarize it with the following analogy, that eventually awareness of our employees in cybersecurity comes with experience. So the more threats we are becoming familiar with, the more tests, the more pictures we've got, the more capable we are to recognize the threat. It's very easy to fall into stereotypes in cybersecurity, especially taking into consideration of, for example, using the example that we've been discussing, how does a hacker look like? Is this a male or female? It doesn't really matter. Is this a person wearing black clothes or white clothes, flowery shirts, not the flowery shirts? You can't say. So we need to be tuned to all of the possibilities that are happening nowadays in cybersecurity. And behavior comes with awareness, means we know how the threat looks like, so we act. But unfortunately, culture comes with understanding, which means in order to build a good cyber awareness in the organization, we need to be understanding all the possible points of entries and threats that we've got in our organization. That's why, guys, we're going to be discussing today the 7 security issues that should not happen in 2019. So let's get started. The first one, and this is a presentation covered with demos, so hopefully you're going to like it. We've got pathetic passwords. And even though we are living in a world of the passwordless ideas and we don't want to use passwords anymore and so on, there are still various technologies in the organizations that are allowing us or even requiring us to use the passwords. And the question is, what does it mean? Let's have a look. So using this particular example, I would like to show you a situation, very nice, one of my favorites, where we actually have the following configuration of the server's environment. Simple thing. Even though you are not maybe technical, that will be picturesque enough to see that this is actually a problem that I've always encountered in every single organization that I've ever been to, because this is pretty much the setting that is like all over out there if you're using Windows servers. So let's have a look. So we've got a service. This is a Paula service, and that particular service is configured on that dedicated account. This account, it's called Freddy Krueger, whatever, but eventually this is an account where whenever we do configure the service and we go to log on to, you're able to see that this is the place where we are putting the password. Now, there's always one rule. If you put a password anywhere, whatever password, whatever, you are always logically sharing it with someone. So the question is, how are we able to extract that password? And in this particular case, it's going to be extremely easy. So let's have a look. First of all, in order to be able to extract the password, we're going to use the PSExec tool, which is a free tool that you can download from sysinternals. So I'm going to elevate myself to local system privileges, as you can see. So we've got local system privileges now. Then I'm going to get into tools, where I'm going to use our Teams tool, which is called CQ Secrets Dumper, and I'm going to use service, a PJ service, like this, in order to extract the password. This is, by the way, a free tool. Our team contributes to cybersecurity. We've written over 200 tools. They're all free. You can download them also from our blog. Why do we share them? Because sharing is caring in cybersecurity, but this is something that eventually I'm using for the pen test. So this is basically why this tool was created. So here we go. Password is there. Now, nicely, we can use that for the lateral movement in the further steps within the company. So one of the cases. Now, whenever we are thinking about all the other situations with the passwords, what I would like to show you is the following situation. So basically, I've got over here a situation where there is this guy, Jimmy Raccoon, on the LinkedIn. Yeah, I'm logged onto my LinkedIn profile right now. We are friends. Surprisingly, Jimmy has 29 other connections too, which is quite funny because Jimmy is a fake account. So we like to invite people. This is an account that our team has created. So what can we say? We do different types of activities out there. If you're wondering where does the face come from, it's not a real face. There is a website. It's called This Person Does Not Exist. Yeah. And you can generate, by pressing F5, a face of a person by using artificial intelligence. So here we go. Looks nice. Okay, good. So let's move forward. So eventually, what can we do? We can get into a little bit more information about Jimmy, right? So there is this contact information about Jimmy, which we can technically display. Yeah, so you can see over here that Jimmy actually, he is like born on the 1st of January, etc. We can see more information about Jimmy as well. We can get down and see what does he like. And we can see that he likes, for example, Tesla. We can see that he was participating in some university of Cayman Islands. Why not? And there is also some, hi. Okay, let's see what Jimmy has to say. Hi. Yeah, my hobby is reading PHP manual. That's interesting. have you heard about whatever, I would like to introduce new ones, blah, blah, blah. Okay, fine. So Jimmy Raccoon has this email. Yeah, this is like an open, like a free service for the email. So question is it possible to attack Jimmy? Now, what I would like to show you is the real case situation that we did to our customer. So basically, if you have, for example, Outlook web access, one of the things that we like to do is either to search information about someone's employees and their private emails and try to recover passwords based on information that they publish in the internet, or we just do the password spraying by leveraging, for example, a company name. Today we've got 2019 or summer 2019 or that kind of stuff. So it's going to be company name 2019. And out of the couple of thousands employees, there's always someone having that type of a password. Now, we could be thinking, is it really like meaningful because it might be just a regular user? Here's the thing. Let me show you why this is actually meaningful. So what I'm doing, I'm taking the Jimmy's account, and basically, I'm putting it on over here into the password recovery service that is related with this WP email. So I would just go further. And then eventually, this is like in Jimmy's language. So this is the questions and answers. So this one says, here we go. What's your dream car? Yeah. And of course, you guys know the answer. Well, that would be Tesla, right? Here we go. And then the time that this guy was born. Okay, so we can calculate that based on the time when he finished his university, for example. So here we've got a year, so it's gonna be like this. And we've got a 1st of January move forward. So eventually, here, this is asking us to set up the new password. So I'm gonna say password, for example, like whatever that will be. Yeah, here we go. It could be an Outlook web access. Maybe it could be just a regular situation for his personal email. I will tell you why it doesn't matter. Because right now, we are able to log on to the Jimmy's mail. So this is what we're going to be doing. So here we go. So let's just do it. And we've got this one. Here we go. Jimmy Raccoon. And then we are doing the password. Perfect. We can log on. And then we're going to have it. Fantastic. So that will be the moment where Jimmy, for example, can be sending you different types of emails. And because you know Jimmy personally, we might at work not check where this email actually come from. And if Jimmy is gonna be sending us a bad stuff, different types of attachment and so on, that makes Jimmy more trustworthy in your eyes in order to get access somewhere. And we've got, of course, access to his mailbox, yeah? So this is basically the situation that is good to start attack, and this is what we mean by thinking and acting like a hacker. So whenever we are thinking about the mitigation for that, of course, one of the things is to teach guys how to eventually create a secure, strong passwords that are consisting of different types of situations that we had, for example, in the morning. I had scrambled eggs, hashtag 123, or whatever. So why am I saying this? Because currently, when we are reading through different types of policies within the companies, they seem to be not approachable. That's why working with passwords, which we still have to do, is unfortunately quite tough. So this is basically something that we would like to discuss over here. Also, figuring things out like KeePass and so on, it doesn't sound like a very modern advice, but this is something that can help us out, though I would like to show you later how to get access to the KeePass because it's not always perfect. And I'm not talking about the KeePass, but I'm talking more about how do we actually manage access to KeePass. So let's have a look at the further steps. Another one that we've got, it's the peeping room. So in general situation where we are not locking our desktops or in general, we're not taking care about the information that we have around us. And this is what I call a cybersecurity context. So everything that is around us creates context for person, meaning I'm expecting this, I'm not expecting that, therefore I'm aware what's my workplace around. But eventually, things like not locking the desktops also I'll create some kind of a danger. And what do we mean by this? Let me tell you. One thing it could be, yes, information can be stolen, but whenever we are thinking about data protection API, this is a platform, cryptographic platform, that my team fully reverse engineered. We are the first ones in the world to do it. I would like to show a couple of things related with that. If someone manages to get access to my box as myself, I'm able to extract all of the different types of secrets that are managed by myself. And what do we mean by this? Well, having a simple look for now, because we're gonna extend that, I'm opening right now ChromePass, and ChromePass, it's a free app that you are able to download in the internet, that, and this app will display me all the different types of passwords that were stored in Chrome. Funny fact, by the way, I've been doing the pen test a little bit over 3 weeks ago, and I managed to get access to the domain admins, but leveraging regular user account system. And eventually, if I use that and I extracted information that was stored in the browser, I was able to get access to not only different types of systems, internal systems that he was managing, but the funny fact was that like there was like this system, that system, whatever, switches, remote logon panels, and Victoria's Secret logon page of his girlfriend. It's like, that's a nice way of storing passwords. So anyway, we've got this, and eventually question would be later how we are able to get access to this from the regular user perspective. So is there a way to fix this? Yes, as we mentioned, one thing, it's a key pass, but the second thing is gonna be related with privileged access management. So question is, what kind of things users can run and what kind of things they cannot? Why we are talking about it? Because one thing is information extraction, but the second thing, it's the USB sticks. So whenever we are thinking about that, question is this something that we are actually managing in our organization? Because in my pocket, I've got a very cool stuff. Let me just do it. This is my, I always have it with me just in case you need it. And this thing, it's called DigiSpark. This is like a small programmable USB plate where you are able to put on all the different types of activities that you might want. This is not visible as a keyboard. This is just visible as a separate, simple device. There's also a keyboard chipset with the rubber ducky, so there are different types of alternative in the internet. But this type of thing is actually pretty cool because it allows me to do lots of different types of things on the user computer, also including running things within the PowerShell, which is rarely recognized within the antivirus solutions if you don't block it properly. And especially we can run the scripts, or we can just type in different types of commands, and that is something that is not really creating that much of an anomaly. Depends on the solutions that we have implemented. Let me show you this, all right? So eventually, we're gonna do it like this. Have a look. We've got a certain type of a box, which I'll bring to the screen in a second. And within this box, here we go, I do have a listener preset, not started though yet, with the netcat minus listen minus verbose on the port 443. So this is the port that in every organization or in most of the organizations is actually allowed. So we're gonna do what? Start it, as simple as this, and I'm listening to this. Now what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna simply plug this in my laptop. So I'm kinda gonna get hug myself eventually, but that's something that I would like to show you basically how it works. So we got it, I'm plugging it in. Here we go. It turns red right now, so it should be fine. And in the moment, what's gonna happen is that this particular USB stick will connect to the hacker that is waiting out there in order to perform some type of activities. Yes, so basically we need to wait approximately 20 seconds for that operation. So long story short, we got this, as you see. And if I do right now, so we can just connect back to this box. Yep, here we go. And if I do right now here, who am I? You can see that I'm Paula. That's great. So I will just do enlarge it a little bit so that you guys can see. Perfect. So I am connected right now to the victim's box. What I will do, I will set up my PowerShell script, which will allow me to run different types of commands. from the hacker's perspective, so bank, PowerShell in general, this is something that is very often unmanaged in the organization because PowerShell is cool, and I agree, for hackers too. And the question is, what can we do next? So I'm gonna just give you one example over here of technically getting access to the someone's camera, and we will see basically if that works. I would just need to make some funny face right now. Okay, let's see if that works. Probably it's gonna be the most humiliating picture that I've ever had, but let's see what is it about. Okay, good, fantastic. Let me get to the site because this picture has been uploaded to the site right now. That's my site, and I've got over here uploads. We are able to refresh this, and then eventually, let's have a look what we got over here, and that's my face over here, yeah? right, so let's take this off before this gets on Twitter or something. Okay, good. So, funny part is that you might have seen it before, right? So hackers getting access to our cameras. That's why we've got all the stickers. This is somewhat managed, but do we actually manage our microphones? And that's my point. Is it better to see you or to hear you? Yeah? Because quite oftenly, this is something that remains unmanaged. Even though the organization implements the stickers for the cameras, they don't manage the policies that are related with the microphones. And these ones are usually on. Think about it, because eventually we can also listen to what you say, and that's a little bit more useful than actually checking on someone's pictures, yeah? So one of the interesting perspectives when we are thinking about the USB sticks and their role. Now, this is really small. So if you, for example, wrap it into the regular container, and when we look at the different types of statistics too, have a look, 19% of people, when they find it, and when there is a company logo on it, they stick it in. And you don't need to run anything on it, you just stick it in. And 60% of people, when it's just a regular USB stick, they take it and they stick it in. That's a quite a nice success ratio when we think about it. So this is something also to be managed. What's the solution for that? Whitelisting. So allowing and disallowing, or technically allowing, applications that we don't that we know, and automatically blocking all the things that we don't know. Ransomware, by the way, when we think about the whole tradition, whole history and so on, the first ransomware in a form as we are dealing with it right now was released in 2015. Yeah, so this was an interesting time when we learned that there is some data that we don't know that can encrypt our data that eventually later is asking for the ransom. So this is something that can be managed, as ransomware also comes out in the PowerShell. So what's next? We've got fish biting. So the situation where guys are getting phishing. And the funny part is that phishing can be really successful. And even though in our team, we are trying to master all these different types of systems, we are still getting different types of emails with the phishing. Now, this is a pretty good example, guys, because it has a context. So I was actually doing a project in US, in Alabama, and I rented a car from Avis. And then I returned the car, and after returning the car, I'm getting this email. So please have a look at the context, because there is a context, car return, and this email sounds like this. Joindress@avisbudget.com, cases are, I'm actually quite pedant, don't get me wrong, there's like too many spaces, this P is different, it's a little smaller, font is different, spaces are missing, and I'm like, I don't like this email. But actually, when we look at this, it doesn't look that bad. The only thing that actually made me not to open this thing, which for the PDF, it's a little small too, was the word requested. Because this is something that missed the context. And it says, thank you for choosing Avis, okay, please find the, attach the requested rental receipt. I did not request for anything, so why am I getting this? And this is something that made me not to open that. That was a time where Adobe was vulnerable like every day. It was a long time ago. Now it's so much better because of the integrity levels. But right now, or at that time, that was a little strange to open it up. And eventually, I've analyzed that PDF with a free tools, which you can download also from the internet. And eventually, there was a malicious JavaScript in it that did the reverse shell to the hacker. So eventually when I open it up, this is something that connects back to the hacker. So when we look at the successful phishing, question is, of course, what are we doing about it? And when we look at the statistics, that's quite funny too, because 100 people in a company, eventually when it gets the, when you get an email, 23 people will open it up. Now, out of that, 11 people will open the attachment that is out there, while it's just enough to have one person, and 6 of them will do it within the first hour. This is how fast that kind of activity spread. So we need to be ready not only from the phishing perspective and having a great anti-spam analyzers, but also we need to be ready for whatever runs. So anything like whitelisting, so not allowing things that we don't know, is pretty much something that we need to be focused on. So just a little bit of a case to highlight the need of implementation of the whitelisting in the organizations right now. Funny fact, again, just to give you a little bit of a fresh glimpse, my team, literally, I was with them in the morning on a call and yesterday also on a call, they literally wrapped up and a part of my team has been deployed to the site to the customer in Germany because their whole site has been affected with the ransomware in 2019. That's interesting, right? But it's a factory and they all got shut down because of that fact. So my team is right now traveling there and they're gonna be helping them. So again, another interesting example that even though we know that this problem exists, we're not addressing it properly, and I think that this is really the time that we should. So what's next? Well, we've got reckless abandon. So all these situations where eventually we've got a device, and this device, it's stolen, lost, gone, whatever the reason is, and we are wondering what can happen to the particular data out there. And this is basically what I would like to show you here. And the question is, of course, are we ready for that type of activity? So long story short, whenever we are thinking about the situation where we've got a user, this is basically the case of a user, user has access to his own data, that's always the rule. So question is there someone else that can access to the user's data? And I would like to show you this. And this is a very serious scenario that needs to be addressed. Let me have a look. So what we're going to do, first of all, our goal over here is going to be to get access to the user's computer. So what we're going to do, we're going to restart that box. Let's do it. We can do both, this attack online and offline. We're going to do it offline because this will help me with the linear approach to the demonstration. And what I will do right now, I will overwrite cache logon data of the user in order to get access to the user's computer to check if we are able to steal user secrets. So this is not only your privacy, but it's also a privacy of your team, etc., and of the whole organization. So what I will do in order to be able to do it with the cache logon data, I will switch off the network because we're going to go offline. So what you're going to do next, and repair computer, troubleshoot, then command prompt, and then I'm going to run one command in order to be able to log on with some other data so that basically you're able to see that even though I'm logging on with the domain user, it's going to be a different password. So that's quite interesting activity too. So let's get into the D drive over here, and we're going to get into the CQ tools, QE CQURE edition, here we go. And then we're going to do for the Mimikatz, which you guys might know, but this is CQURE edition. This edition is actually not recognized by most of the antivirus solutions, vast majority actually. LSA dump, cache, and we are overriding cache logon data, sometimes called by us cache credentials, which are not really credentials though, config, and we're going to do system, and then we're going to do D, and we're going to override that. Let me just do it live, config, and then security, slash kiwi, and then enter. So what we've done right now, we have overwritten a cache logon data. Now we can log on to the domain users with any password you want, with literally any password you want. Let's prove that, and let's see if under these conditions, we are able to get access to someone's secrets, okay? So that we are able to see, are we safe or not, okay? In the meantime, what we're gonna do, while this machine is rebooting, I would like to show you one of the interesting ways of getting access into the user's secrets. So Freddy Krueger, had a password, as you can see by the service at the beginning of the presentation, password, enter. This time doesn't work out. Why? Because we've changed that. So this time password's gonna be Mimikatz, like this, and we can log on. And this is the moment where we are logging on as the domain user with a different password. Yeah? That's kind of cool because this violates all these things that are called non-repudiation. Yes? So we are logged on over here. Fine. So what I'm gonna do right now is that I would like to show you how eventually we are able to get access to the secrets of that particular user. Let me just pull it out for the moment once again. We've got here Chrome Pass. So this one is looking for a long time for the password of the user. We're trying to get access to it, but eventually, because we have logged on with a different password, our secret will not be available, which brings us to the conclusion, our secrets are as safe as our password is. So the stronger password you've got, the stronger your secret's gonna be protected. And if you have a look over here, the password is empty. But there's always some but in cybersecurity, right? I wouldn't be here, you wouldn't be here if it was all that pretty, so let's do a little bit of a damage. Ha! So now, what we're gonna do, in order to get access to the user's secrets, we need to do the following thing. So this is the ultimate way of getting access to the organization and violating every employee's privacy. And my job over here, it's not to scare you. My job is to show you the importance of how important it is in the organization to manage privilege access and also identities in general. So let's have a look, what can we do? And that's gonna be extremely simple. So what we're gonna do over here is that I'm gonna here export one thing, and that one thing, it's gonna be the key that is stored within the domain controller that all of you have, no exceptions. And this is something that our team reverse engineered, and we published that as our DP API research. Happy to give you more information, but let's see what does it mean. So we're gonna do export, so file exported PFX. We're gonna export a private key from the domain. You are not able to find it in any certificates container or anywhere else. So eventually, what we can do, we can import that. We don't have to though, but let me do it. Password for this is CQURE, so our team's, our company's name. Next, 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 finish. Okay, fine. Cert MGR.msc, let's have a look. And this certificate looks like this. Not available. Issued to nobody, issued by nobody. So quite interesting. Valid from this year to that year, only 1 year. So if you have set up your domain in 2003, because you've been running before on Windows Server 2003, and you did multiple upgrades, that doesn't matter. That doesn't matter. You can't renew it, anything else like this. Now, another part is that here we've got RSA, that's fine, SHA-1. That's not very happy news, isn't it? And it's also 2048 bits key. So if your domain is for the past, whatever, 15 years, this key has been probably already cracked. Yeah, so what do we need to monitor nowadays is everything that executes on the domain controllers. So any kind of whitelisting solutions, or at least monitoring what runs, it's crucial to make sure that we know what's going on in our systems. Now, why this? Certificate is nice, but let's see how it works. So over here, what we're gonna do for Freddy, in order to get access to the Freddy's password, is this. We're gonna do %updata%, and basically, within the Microsoft, Protect, SID, these are something that we call master keys of the user. Master keys are the ones that are protecting your secrets. If you want to do a bad joke to someone, you should delete this folder. Yeah? That means that nobody will be able to log on to any whatever secrets that they ever stored. I find it funny, by the way. But anyway, when we look at the further steps over here, I know actually that the secret that's going to be the master key that is protecting the secret is this B55 thing. So we will need to work on this guy. So shift, right click, and we're going to do copy as path. What's next? In the context of the user, not any admin or anything like that, we're going to get into the CQ tools. Here we go. And we're going to get into the context of DP API. And over here, we're going to do one thing. So we're going to generate first hash. CQ hashcalc for the current password, so mimikatz, perfect. And then we're going to use another tool, which is called CQ master key ID, to first give a master key that we're going to be decrypting with the PFX that we've got from the domain, and then with the encrypting it back with the new hash. That's a bit complex situation that we're having right now, but eventually, in my own words, if we should describe of what's going on, is that we are decrypting and encrypting, once again, the user's secrets, all of the user's secrets. So let's do it right like this. Bang, we got it. Fantastic. So what happened? We have a new AD modified key created. So what we're going to do, we're going to rename this guy over here, and we're going to rename it to, well, let's say good, why not? Here we go. And then we're going to take this AD modified, here we go. And then eventually, we're going to rename this into this particular file as we are having it, so it's all good. And the last part, in order to succeed, we will need to give it an attribute of a system and hidden. Let's do it, bang, enter. And then the question is, do we have our password available? Bang, we do. So what just happened? Yeah, so it's quite short, quite fast situation. But what just happened is that because someone managed to get access to the one key from the DC, we were able to decrypt a secret of a domain user. That applies to every single domain user in your organization. So if you have 100,000 people working for you, domain admin, it's extremely powerful. And I know you know that, but that's another perspective on that. What's the bad news here is that if your environment once ever has been hacked, and we've got customers like that, then the question is, did someone manage to get ntds.dit from the domain? If so, then there is a never-ending potential threat of extracting people's secrets. That's why the protection level that we should apply in our organizations from that perspective is crucial. Can I be brutal? Yeah, okay. Yeah, I saw you like that from the very beginning, so let's do that. You know what I would do? If I'll be on the bad side, that's going to be super brutal, by the way, but sorry, yeah? So I'll do the following. If I hack someone's domain as a hacker, I would extract that types of secrets, passwords for people from LinkedIn, Facebook, and all that stuff, and I won't destroy your infrastructure, but I will log on to Facebook, LinkedIn, and other stuff, and I will do something that we call public shaming. So I will accuse the company that I'm working at of harassment, for example. So something really, really bad. And it's not true, but sorry, if 10 people will do it and I will have all the secrets, then in every story there's a little bit of a true. And we don't want these stickers, labels to be on us for the next 10 years until our public relations cleans it out. And that's my point. That's the perspective we are eventually looking at. Okay, guys, so what's the case for that? Of course, incident response plan is one thing, but also implementation of the good monitoring, it's another part. So another thing, just to mention, it's the monitoring of the network. So basically the situation where we've got a moment when someone is traveling, for example, and it's connecting to the business apps, to the business applications. Let me show you something, and that's a very short demonstration. This is pretty much an example of the business app, right? So let me pull it out. So this is a business app, simply SQL Server, where I'm able to execute a regular query, and that's what I did. So if I just do execute, then it pulls me data out of the database. Now here I have logins opened, and you do not see the logon hacker. You cannot see it, because it's not there. Eventually, what I will do, I'm going to monitor that type of traffic to the database application on the fly with my Linux box over here, which I'm going to log on to. And what we're going to do over here, we're going to replace the data on the fly. What is this method? This method is called? Simply speaking, this is relying on the tabular data stream. So the SQL Server default communication running in a clear text. Pretty much most of the organizations have this problem. What I'm going to use for that activity, it's the SQL inject script, where I'm going to replace the query, which I'm able to sniff in the network with my own query. So this is a very big problem. So let me do it right now. So I'm running that listener right now. And if I switch back to my SQL application, let's have a look over here, perfect. I'm gonna do run that again. So let's just go a little bit up. So here we go, execute. Now this time it does not display me the table, but it displays me the commands completed successfully. That's quite disturbing. Why? Because the simple query to the database allowed me, refresh, to create a login hacker just because the traffic from this application was not saved properly. Now, default implementation of the databases has this problem. And if we did not make explicitly an effort to secure the traffic, that's the problem. So eventually, this is what we might share while we are connecting into someone's network. Maybe we'll be connecting as well to our business app. That's the point of entry. That's the perspective of the hacker. We should definitely analyze this as one of the points of entry. And the last thing, number seven, is that we are sometimes a little bit too social, meaning we share too much information in the internet. We had an example with the Jimmy raccoon at the very beginning, but there are also, and I'm sure you know, many other examples. Well, we are a little bit too trustworthy to what we see. Now, there is a very nice app you guys may have a look at, but there are many types of apps like this. I'm not advertising anything, of course, just have a look. It's called Spoof ID. While you are able to pretend that you are someone else, if this person on the other side has the other person in the contacts list. So let's say I've got someone in the contacts list, so someone else, just because of that fact, can pretend that this is this person calling. And it's an absolutely lovely situation to pretend that you are someone else on the mobile phones. This is, by the way, illegal activity, but again, as we mentioned, who cares if you've got a certain type of a goal to reach? So summarizing, what are the best practices? Understanding, of course, as we know, is key to the security. So any type of a point of entries analysis we can make, it's always putting us one step further in implementing of the successful cybersecurity strategy. Putting on the hacker's shoes, so having a look, the brutal look at our infrastructure, pretty much focusing on the whole umbrella within the cybersecurity always makes sense, but prevention, so anything that we were showing today can be implemented or can be fixed by implementing all things like whitelisting solutions, things like machine learning based solutions that are allowing us to understand not only the situation and behavior, because this can be bypassed, but also a context. And at the end, guys, if you want to look at the additional resources, a little bit of the magazines over here mentioned, this is something that I personally follow, because even though sometimes it's not enough technical for me, this is something that represents a good news pages of this world to learn of what's going on, also from a more descriptive perspective to see what is the whole cybersecurity threatscape. And at the very end, if you like the presentation, I would like to invite you to download the tools and slides. So anything that I've been showing today, you can download. And the shortest link is the cq.re/RSA keynote. And this site has been published 5 minutes ago to be the freshest summary of the 2 days keynote. Thank you so much and have a great rest of the day.